5, 4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
When I had come down this hill, I had seen this creature cross the road. It would have ripped my locked door from my truck, extracted me from my vehicle, and there wouldn't have been a damn thing I could have done about it.
This thing, I got to notice in its eyes. Its eyes was real, real evil, real sinister looking. You know, the look it was giving me.
What are you reporting?
Jesus Christ, you better...
Sir? Hello?
Get somebody out here.
What's going on now, sir?
That son of a bitch is about 6'9", I don't know.
Do you see him now, sir?
Yes, I'm looking right at him.
Uh-oh.
Welcome to Bigfoot Hotspot Radio, Sasquatch Chronicles. I'm your host, Wes, along with my brother, Woody, and researcher, author, and friend, William Jeffy. Let's start the show. This episode is brought to you by Audible.com. Go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot for your first free 30-day trial membership and your first free downloadable book. Tonight on the show, we have Tim Baker, a.k.a. Coonbo. Coonbo comes to us from, he's a good friend of Bear's. We had Bear on the show last week, and he's always full of great stories, great encounters, and I really thought the listeners would enjoy having him on the show, listening to his experiences. So let's go ahead and bring Tim on the show.
Hi, pleasure to meet you guys.
Really appreciate you coming
sure.
on the show and taking the time and... I know you take a lot of time and with people, and so we really do appreciate you coming on and sharing your encounters with us.
I would just say I've been doing this since the 1970s, and I first heard about what I came to understand is Bigfoot from my grandfather back in 1958. So that's 58, not 68, but got very interested in it back in the 70s, and so later on when I went to work for the government and started traveling extensively, I started researching, all over the country. So, been a lot of places, done a lot of things, seen a lot of stuff.
A lot of our listeners have been asking us, and is it respectful for us to call you Coonbo?
Sure, yeah.
Okay. I want to make sure it's... A lot of our listeners have been saying, hey, ask Coonbo about this question. Ask Coonbo about this encounter. Ask him to tell a story about this, And it's probably gotten to a point where a lot of them know the story's probably better than yourself, huh?
I do seem like I get on these blog talk shows and I get asked the same thing over and over again. I'm up for answering other questions besides just the same old stories as well. So you guys reach a different audience than other places that I've spoken. So I don't mind repeating some of it.
Yeah, no, we'd love to hear some of the encounter stories. One question I wanted to ask you, Coonbo, right off the bat is, and I know you and I talked earlier, what do you think Sasquatch is? What do you think these things are out there running around?
First of all, I think it's a flesh and blood, I'm a flesh and blood believer. And in fact, I'm not a believer, I'm a knower, I've gone through all kind of things. I've gone through that it's just, some kind of an undiscovered primate or, hominid. I've been through that, it's remnant population of Gigantopithecus. I've been through that my idea about it has changed over the years. I'll tell you what, after I saw the book, Them and Us, supposedly more accurate depictions of the Neanderthals, that is so close to many of them that I've seen. I'm inclined to believe that it may be some kind of a remnant Neanderthal, a Neanderthal hybrid, a Neanderthal mutation or something like that. But the pictures in that Them and Us book, other than the vertical slit pupils, and the nose is not quite right. And I've never seen them carrying a spear or anything like that. You know, take the spear away, make the nose a little bit more human-like, and get rid of the vertical slit pupils, and you've got what myself and Bear and been seeing for years, you know, most of our lives. And now, we've also seen the ones that look more Patty-like, the ones that when I moved to Mississippi, that were my neighbors there, they looked like the Neanderthal-looking ones out of the Them and Us book. I'm telling you, the first time I saw that book and, you know, and saw the pictures in it, I got chili bumps all over me. My hair stood up, and you know, I got a chill ran up and down my spine when I saw it.
And you know, that's what Wes and I were talking about before you come on, was that a lot of people lump everything into the term Bigfoot, and it really is at least two different species. Mm-hmm. Like you mentioned, the Patty one, and then the slightly smaller one, possibly Neanderthal version.
And then there's the dog-faced ones, the werewolf-looking ones, that I first heard about in 1984, outside of between Troy and Union Springs, Alabama. I was down there running a project for NASA with a company that was building communications equipment with NASA. And I had a bunch of people working for me on a production line. Two ladies came to work one day that were, one was in her 40s and probably the other one's in early 50s. And these were, you know, just sort of two of my main people there on the line. And, you know, very, very, very competent, you know, technical type folks that were just whizzes at assembling very complicated electronics gear. They came in to work, they rode to work together, and they came in crying and shaken up very, very badly, and to the point, you know, everybody, what's the matter, you know, everybody's asking them, and they didn't want to tell anybody. So we always had a little kickoff meeting every morning and went over what had been done by the night shift crew and all. Anyway, so I got everybody out and going, and these two ladies were just, they obviously weren't concentrating on what I was saying. So I said, come on in here. Let's talk. And came in my office. I shut the door and y'all have a seat. I said, what's the matter? They didn't want to talk. And I said, look, you can tell me. I don't care what it is, how far-fetched it is. I'd love to hear it. And then they told me about, they encountered one of the werewolf looking ones on the way to work. First time I'd ever heard about it. But we went out there that evening after work, and they showed me where they had seen it, and it turned out it was about 9 feet tall, and I found tracks. I found where it had scaled a 12 to 13 foot almost vertical dirt bank where the highway 29 came through, and they had scaled it. Scaled it in two steps. I found its tracks. And they were different enough than the regular booger tracks that I had been seeing a large part of my life. These ladies had no idea that I knew anything at all about Bigfoot or Sasquatch or anything. I totally 100% believe their story. And ever since then, I've been interested in these dog-faced ones, and I've been collecting and talking to people and collecting, you know, reports of these things from around the country ever since then. There's three species of them out there, at least.
And that's what I was going to ask you, Tim. Do you hypothesize that the dogmen are just another version of, quote, Bigfoot or Sasquatch, just an off branch of one of these?
I tell you what, I truly do not know. I have been able to study them enough to know that they live in areas where there are also standard Bigfoot / Sasquatch type of populations. I've only ever found one area, and that was out in western Oklahoma, where they were the predominant type that were out there.
I heard they tend to be a little bit more aggressive, don't they?
Supposedly so, yes. The ladies that saw it coming to work that morning, it sat there and looked at them. It stood on the side of the road and watched them as they went by. The lady slammed on the brakes trying to stop. She thought it was fixing to run out in front of her. She slammed on the brakes, and what she ended up doing, she was going too fast, she ended up almost coming to a stop right there beside it. And it stayed on the side of the road. It looked in the window at them, and then she rolled by it and then stomped on the gas, and it crossed the road behind them and ran up the bank. They didn't see it run up the bank. They weren't looking in the rearview mirror at it, nor did they even turn around to look at it. But I found its tracks going up the bank behind them. And I could tell where it had come up the bank to the point where it was standing when they saw it, you know, when they passed it. It came up from the east side of the highway and crossed the highway east to west after they went by and ran up the bank, you know, headed west. There were some people north of Tulsa, Oklahoma, that where I investigated one that was 11 feet tall. This one was not attacking them. It came up multiple times, snooping around their house and their yard and stuff, and they actually saw it one time standing there looking over the hedge bush behind their house at them. And we determined that it had to have been 11 feet tall for its head to be where they saw it. It never attacked them or anything, never beat on their house or anything like that, but they were pretty much terrorized by it. Now, out in further, quite a bit west of there, out in, you know, western Oklahoma, where there was a group of them, those were belligerent. The locals there were quite scared of them. The ones down in East Texas, northeast Texas, those were supposedly quite belligerent as well, and some of the locals were scared of them. But now, I've never seen one, and I've never had an encounter with one.
Well, let me ask you this, Tim, and I wanted to talk a little bit about some of the encounters that you and I were talking about before we hung up earlier today. I have several listeners. There's one in particular from Australia. I won't embarrass her and share her name. She was wanting to know if you would tell a story about the subway platter, the neighbor's dog stool, and then the puppies by the bay window.
Okay, I'm going to tell them a little bit in chronological order. Let's start with the puppies by the bay window. I worked for a company this is after I left the government in 1993 and went out into the real world. And I ended up, after a few years, I was working for a company that makes high precision tubing that's used in the air conditioning industry as well as other things. And anyway, I was living. They had sent a group of us down to do a bunch of work in a plant, Boonville, Mississippi. Since we were officially sort of on temporary duty down there, they just rented houses for us. And since I had dogs, there was one available that was out in the country, and I chose that one. Lived out there, and I hadn't been in there very long at all, and I discovered that the house was a little bit isolated, but I figured out pretty quickly that there were boogers around. I had my dog, Bo, which turned out to be, you know, my big old German Shepherd that turned out to be an absolutely fantastic booger dog, and he went everywhere with me. And you can talk to a bunch of my friends that, you know, that used to go researching with me, and, you know, Bo was on every trip we made. And he knew boogers. He knew when they were around. Also, at the time, I had a Southern Mountain Cur female, and through mistake made someone expecting that they could keep Bo locked in a kennel outside when my little Southern Mountain Cur female was in heat, and that didn't happen. He busted right out and bred her, and I ended up with a litter of a half German Shepherd, half Mountain Cur puppies. And I first had them outside in the nice kennel that I had out there. I figured out really quickly that the boogers were coming up there, and I knew they were trying to get my dogs. I would hear Mandy out there just raising holy hell in a full-blown defensive mode. What drove it home to me is my son and I came home from, we'd been to town, and it got dark on us, and we came turning down the road that I lived on. As I came around the corner, my headlights swung across my yard and the road in front of the house, and there was the alpha male at least one other right out there in front of my house. And in fact, the alpha male was standing in the road. When my headlights hit them, you know, the high beams, they dove off and took off, jumped off the road and took off running. And I got to thinking, and when I pulled up there, Mandy was there in the kennel, and her hackles were all standing up, and she was just frantic. And I realized that the boogers had been in there trying to get the pups. So I brought the pups in the house, her and the dogs in the house after that, and rigged up a deal up in the kitchen, which had a linoleum floor up there so they couldn't mess it up very much. Rigged up a deal where she and the pups could stay up there. I was in the habit of leaving the windows open. I mean, the curtains open. I started having a lot of activity right around the house, and some of my friends came over, and we'd had a rain, big heavy rain. You might have seen Dan Ricky and his wife. She goes by the screen name of Shasta, and they drove over from Oklahoma, and Bear and some others came up. We were going to do some researching in some areas around there. Well, the first thing Vicky did is she walked around the north end of the house, and lo and behold, there's all these booger tracks right there in front of the bay window. And we started measuring the stride of them, and from measuring from heel to heel, that's the way, when you're measuring the stride of anything walking, you measure from either the toe of one track to the same spot on the toe of the next track, or the heel to the heel. You know, you don't measure from the heel of one to the other, or the toe of one to the heel of the other. To get the true stride, you measure from the same point on each successive track. And this dude was taking 60-something, in a normal walk, this dude was taking 60-something inch strides. In other words, strides a little bit over 5 foot long. And you try to duplicate that. I'll tell you something else. From when I came around the corner, my son and I came around the corner, and I caught him in my high beams, and he jumped off the road. I found where he was standing, and where he whirled, and he jumped off the side of the road, where his first foot hit the ground. It was 15, right at 15 feet to the heel. Where his next foot hit the ground, it was from the previous one, it was like 21 feet to the heel. Where the next one hit the ground was 23 feet, 22 or 23 feet. Son of a gun made three leaps and covered, what is that, 50, 22, 23, that's 45 plus 15. He covered basically 60 feet in three strides from a standing stop.
I can totally believe that. I heard one run one time years ago, and we heard it hit the ground maybe five times, and it was well over 100 feet.
Reminds me of our encounter with the gray one. I mean, that thing cleared some distance with one leap.
These things can move like you cannot believe. I mean, you can't believe the ground that they can cover. This afternoon, you know, telling Wes about, we saw some, we ran up on five of them, you know, four smaller ones and one larger one. They were so far away, I couldn't tell you how big they were, but they were running down a power line right away. And this is a place we were going back there to chase deer on the power line right away. This is a place, that big hillside where the deer like to lay out there in sun. And we'd come flying over the hill, you know, sort of like the old Rat Patrol TV show. You'd come flying over the hill, and we hit, and the deer are out there, and you know, and we're on the four-wheelers. We're already running pretty hard and fast, and the deer are popping up, and we chase them. And we popped the hill and jumped over the top of the hill, and what popped up in front of us about, you know, 400 yards out, five really dark-looking things, and they go hauling ass down the power line right away. And I slammed on the brakes, and my buddy Don came skidding up beside me, and he goes, "What the hell is that?" And I said, I had binoculars around my neck, and I threw binoculars up, and I'm looking, and I said, and the first thing I saw was it looked like a bunch of chimpanzees running away from me on all fours. And they were absolutely flying. I estimated them going, you know, 35 to 40 at least. And I'm looking at them, and I'm thinking, holy shit, what are chimpanzees doing back here? And suddenly it dawned on me, the one in the front, the big one in the front, he slammed on the brakes, and he turned around and stood up and looked back up at us for just a split second, no more than a second, and dropped down to all fours and darted to the left and piled off in the woods. And the other four, you know, they start doing about a 3G turn and run off in the woods behind him. In fact, one of them had already, you know, shot past him and had to really pull a sharp curve. And they're like, you know, what is it? You know, my son's, Daddy, what is it? And I'm sitting there looking. I said, something like hogs, maybe. And I said, hell, don't look like the hog to me. And I'm looking there, and I can't remember the exact verbiage, but it's something like I was trying to think of anything to say other than Bigfoot, because, you know, they would have given me absolute hell at the hunting camp. You know, I'd have never heard the end of it.
And Tim, was that the same place where they charged you? Was that the same location?
I've been charged a couple of times, but I was charged on that property, myself and another guy when we were coyote hunting back there one night. That's a story I haven't told very much. The stories that you've probably heard of me being charged was over at a place we call AP Road, or which it stands for Asshole Pucker Road. We were charged by three of them there.
If you don't mind, tell the coyote story, and then we can go over to the AP Road one. I'd love to hear the coyote one.
For those of you who haven't been down in the southeastern United States, they plant a lot of pine plantations, and, you know, they use the pines for lumber, you know, yellow pine lumber, but a lot of it is grown and cut for pulpwood, for making paper. When they come in and cut these pines, they take it down to the ground, and then they immediately come in and replant it, and we call areas cutover areas. And they will, what happens is when they come in and replant all these pine seedlings, what comes up first is there all kind of weeds and plants and stuff that normally wouldn't grow because they were shaded out by the trees, but also ungodly briars, saw briars. And I'm talking about the stalks of these briars are as big around as your thumb, and they'll grow up, you know, 11, 12 feet high. They're so unbelievably thick and stout that if you come in through there on a tractor, even with a brush hog or a bush hog, we call them, trying to mow them down, they can be so thick that as your tractor tries to ride them down, they bend over on you. And if it's a tractor without a cab on it, you know, it's an open seat tractor, they'll get a hold of you and they'll damn near drag you off the tractor. And they will literally tear you to shreds. They will shred your clothes and your hide. And they grow up so thick that you can hardly crawl through these cutover areas on your hands and knees. That's how thick it gets. And plus all these little saplings and stuff will come up from the hardwood tree roots that are left. So these cutover areas are unbelievably thick. And after about, for the first 5 to 8 years, unbelievable. After about 8 or 9 years, the pines get up high enough that they shade out a lot of this stuff, and a lot of the briars and the stuff will die back. So we were back, our hunting camp leased a lot of these, leased the big pine plantation. And there was an area that, there was a 160-acre piece of fresh cutover that had just been cut over that spring and summer. And then just to the north of it was another 160 acres of cutover that was about 5 or 6 years old. So it's grown up about, you know, 10 foot high, 10, 11 foot high, and all these weeds and briars and mess, this impenetrable mass of stuff. All right. Then there's fire breaks all through these, separating all these little plots. And the fire breaks are roads. You drive on them. And it just so happened that at this one particular place, the fire break road runs right along the top of a ridge. This ridge runs nearly perfectly east and west. And there's a perfect 160 acres of fresh cut over to the south, and a perfect 160 acres of about 5 or 6 year cut over to the north. So we'd been deer hunting back there. We decided, we drove my old truck up there, and we parked up again on the road, and we're up. My old truck was painted sort of OD green, and it's up against the that cutover up on this ridge. But we're not skylined because the cutover is behind us, so it's really quite well camouflaged. But we have a complete view, a perfect view of every bit of this half-mile square area, this 160-acre area to the south of us. So we crawl up in the back of the truck, and we get all set up, get our guns out ready to shoot, and one of us has a dying rabbit call, and a varmint call. So one of us gets on this dying rabbit call and just sits down on it, I mean, really cuts loose with a, you know, god-awful bunch of racket. Instantly, to the north of us, about 3/8 of a mile, out across the high cut over to the north of us, there's this ungodly roaring scream, and like what you described earlier, Wes, the lion's roar, just roar, or the T-Rex scream. Instantly, we whirl around and it's a really bright quarter moon, and it wasn't fully dark anyway, so you can still see pretty dadgum good down through there, out through there. In fact, you can see all the way across it very well. All of a sudden, we realize there's this damn wake coming through the cutover straight towards us like it's on a string. And to get an idea, if you've watched Jurassic Park, the original Jurassic Park, the first one, the part where they're out in that big grassy field and the velociraptors are attacking them, and they show the aerial view and you can see the wake of the velociraptors tearing through that grass headed towards those people. There is a damn wake of something coming straight towards us. And I mean, it's coming through there doing probably 25 miles an hour through this thing. Unbelievable. I mean, tearing through this thing. I can't think of anything, any kind of an animal, anything that, I mean, you couldn't tear through there like that on a four-wheeler. You absolutely could not do it through cut over like that. And this thing is on a beeline straight towards us, screaming its head off. My buddy and I, there was no thought or anything. I don't know how we did it. The next memory that I have, we were in the truck. I don't know how we got out of the back of the truck and in the truck. I don't know if we just came, did a Dukes of Hazzard jump through the windows, NASCAR style jump through the windows or what, but the next thing I remember, we were in the truck, and I had the keys out, and I was trying to crank it. And we hadn't been sitting there very long, and I didn't have a very good starter in that engine. And the compression hadn't leaked down. So when I turned the key, all it started doing, it was going, whoa, whoa, whoa. And the son of a bitch wouldn't crank. And the damn thing's getting closer. My buddy is sitting over there on the passenger side of the truck, and his is the side towards the cutover, and this thing's getting louder and louder. We can hear it just crashing through the cutover, and he's screaming, hurry up, let's go, and I'm trying, and the son of a bitch lets out this huge scream, and I mean, it's shaking the damn windows of the truck, and my buddy is crawling over on top of me, trying to get away from the window, and I'm, get off of me, you're going to break the goddamn key off, get off, and I'm trying to elbow him off of me while trying to get the damn truck cranked, and this thing is screaming and raising holy hell, and finally, about the time it burst out of the cutover, the truck cranks up, I yank the thing in gear, and I go roaring out of there, slinging gravel and stuff. The bad part about it was after about a mile and a half, we had to stop and unlock a locked gate to get out of there. And this damn thing was running through the cutover as fast as I could drive my truck on the road, that damn firebreak road. And so we got to the gate, and it took a little bit for either one of us to figure out, was it still chasing us? Was it safe to get out and unlock the gate or anything? And we both jumped out with our rifles up, and one of us unlocked the gate, and then we piled back in the truck, and we went tearing off out of there.
I wanted to ask you, now you had another encounter where you'd been charged and by three individuals, and it was kind of a standoff with your shotguns.
Right.
That's
AP Road, yeah.
Yeah, AP Road.
We had been over there researching around in northeast Mississippi, and Bear had come over and spent the weekend with me, and we had, like I said, we'd been out researching and, you know, checking out different places. Well, on his way home on a Sunday evening, he pulled into a particular overlook on the Natchez Trace Parkway, and he was caught short and had to relieve himself. This little overlook area was sort of a, you know, you could pull back and you could get out of sight of the highway there. You could pull off. The little picnic area was far enough off the trace that you couldn't see it, and, you know, you could step out there and relieve yourself. It was still daylight. That's one of the reasons why he's trying to find someplace a little bit more privacy. He was relieving himself and heard something off in the distance, and just to, when he got done, he let out a call and instantly got an answer. And then, in just a few seconds, another, it answered him again, and it was closer. It was obviously coming to him. Anyway, this particular booger came all the way up there to the picnic area in the daylight, raising cane as it did. It eventually just stopped and was just sort of milling around out there, and it was grumbling and carrying on some racket, if I remember correctly. And I may be a little bit wrong about those details, but Bear had to get on down the road, so he didn't mess with it very much. He got back in his truck and headed back home. But he called me and told me about it. A day or two later, I decided to go down there after work, and while it was still daylight, and see if I could get any results. So I went down there. I pulled into the place, and it was calm, and everything was fine. And I made a mistake when I pulled in there. I always, my dad taught me this from the time I was a kid. When you pull your truck off into an area, you always turn it around and get it pointed on the way out. Always. Well, for some reason, when I pulled into this picnic ground for probably one of the few times in my entire life, I didn't turn the truck around and have it pointed out for some reason. And I got out, and everything was calm and all, and I stood around, you know, listening for a few minutes, and I heard nothing. Well, I let out a call. Instantly, I got an answer from exactly the same direction that Bear said he had gotten an answer from. And then in a few seconds, I heard it again. It was obviously coming closer. And it was coming at a high rate of speed. And it came up, and I could hear it coming. And I thought, well, I'll be able to see it cross the parkway. Because it was coming from the other side of the parkway. I heard it as it was approaching the parkway, and I was looking right where I thought it should cross, and then the next time I heard it, it was on my side of the parkway, and it was down the hill below the first picnic tables. I thought, hell, how'd that thing get over there, you know, and it was obviously pissed, and then it hollered again, and it was right straight down the hill below me when I turned around and looked down there. Down at the bottom of the hill, I see a gravel road. And I said, well, dang, I didn't see that before. And the son of a gun, here it came up the hill, crashing through the brush, raising cane, and it was seriously angry. And I said, and I was by myself, didn't even have bow with me, didn't have a gun of any kind with me. I said, I need to get my butt out of here. Got in the truck, and oh, crap. I had to turn that damn big F-250 around. I had an F-250 Super Duty diesel with a crew cab. You know, and it takes 40 acres to turn them around in. I started juking back and forth trying to turn the damn truck around, and I had to back the damn truck towards the booger. By this time, it had gotten to the top. It was at the top of the hill. It came busting out of the woods, and it had a big stick in its hand about 5 foot long and about as big around as my arm. And about the time I got the thing, my truck turned enough that I could head out. Its sidearm, I saw it in the mirror, it reared back and it slung that stick at me sidearm. And his tick came, you know, and it slammed into the passenger side of the bed of the truck. I mean, it made a big racket. I had the truck not even 2 weeks, and I go tearing out of there. I get home, and there's a big-ass dent in the side of the truck. And that cost me $700 with dent doctors in Tupelo, Mississippi, to get the dent sucked out. I wasn't about to turn that in on my insurance. We go back down there a time or two, and again, every time we went down there, we would have activity, and the alpha would show up. But we got to noticing this dirt road. How do we get onto this dirt road so we can drive back in here even further? And so one of our research buddies is a guy named Sammy Armstrong, and he was a retired trucker, and he was a Vietnam veteran, and he had a very steady nerve, really, really, really good guy to have with you out in the rough. Sammy took it upon himself to start trying to find how to get into this gravel road that we could see down the hill below this picnic area. And he finally figured it out. And I mean, my God, it's like we had to drive to Minnesota to get onto the right road to get into this dirt road that went into Mississippi, you know, through this patch of woods in Mississippi. And we had to go way around this way. And I kept asking him, are you sure you know what you're doing? Are you sure? And he, yeah, just trust me. Based on our experience there, we both were packing pistols, and we both had our riot guns with us, our 12-gauge, you know, pump shotguns. So we're going down the hill in this narrow little road. We had our windows down, and all of a sudden, this damn thing screamed right in my door, in my window. And it was so loud, it made my ears ring. That's how loud it was. I mean, it just shook us, scared the crap out of both of us. Well, I speeded up a little bit, and we went down the hill, and the road came out into a field. I was wanting to try to go further across the field away from that cutover area to have a little bit of maneuvering room. But as soon as the road came out into the field, the little bit of gravel that had been on it disappeared, and I felt the truck starting to sink down into the ground. And that's an 8,000-pound truck, and, you know, when you stick an 8,000-pound truck, all you've got then is just a monument. You know, you're not getting that dude out of there. So I immediately, while I still had a little bit of solid ground underneath me, I started turning the truck around. And as we were turning the truck around, over the noise of that diesel engine, we could hear the boogers up the hill screaming and yelling. And then the really bad part about it, we realized there was more than one of them raising holy hell. And we got the truck turned around. We thought that we heard, that we could hear them crashing down through the cutover towards us. And we got out of the truck. We walked around to the front of the truck, and we could definitely hear them, you know, they were tearing through the brush headed our way. We backed up against the brush guard, and about that time, they burst out of the cutover into the open. And they ran there were three of them, and they ran about 8 to 10 feet out into the field when they saw us, and they slammed on the brakes. And we're sitting there with our shotguns on our shoulder, fingers on the trigger, safety off. And I'm telling you, both of us were shaking in our boots. And I was so scared, I wanted to try to back away and back around and get in the truck. I was scared to. We were sitting there eyeball to eyeball, guys. And I felt like if we moved, if we did anything to back off, that they would attack us. I thought there's a chance that Sammy and I might be able to knock down one of them, and if we're lucky, two, but there was no way that we were going to stop all three, that they had us if they wanted us. They stood there, and just, you could see they'd draw up a huge breath, and they'd roar, you know, they were just roaring their heads off at us. One of them, I figured, was the alpha. It was a little bit bigger, and it was probably 8, 8.5 feet tall. And it was of the type that, like the Neanderthal-looking type. But it was still monstrous, huge big barrel chest on it. And when it would start to scream, its arms and its muscles would tense up, and you could see all the musculature in them. And the other two were just slightly smaller. They were maybe, you know, 7.5 feet tall, something like that, maybe close to 8. The big one, I would guess that the big one probably weighed 650 to 750, maybe even 800 pounds, and the other ones maybe 100 pounds less than that, something like that, probably still 600, 650 pounds. I don't know. They were monstrous. And you could see, I mean, you could even see the muscles in their thighs rippling and stuff. And as they would scream at us, it was almost like they were sort of like leaning over, and they were giving it everything they had. We just stood there, and they just sort of screamed themselves out over a period of, I mean, it seemed like, you know, quite a long time, but it probably only lasted 30, 45 seconds. And I can't tell you how many times they screamed at us, probably a total of at least 3 or 4 times each, maybe more than that. And the volume was incredible. It was shaking our clothes. It was shaking our chests. It was literally, my eardrums have been ruptured a couple of times. And when I hear loud noises, my ears, I get this crackling, really loud noise, make this crackling noise in my ears now. And it was doing that to me. And like I was almost in a rock concert, it was so loud. It's almost like they decided that they weren't going to run us off. And they stopped, and they're sitting there, and they're sort of like, you know, taking these, almost like panting, you know, because they've been putting out so much effort. Sam and I were panting because we were scared half to death. And then the alpha, he just sort of looked at us, and he turned to his left and just walked back into the brush, and the other two turned and followed behind him. The thing about it is we heard them walk up in there a ways, but then they stopped. We heard some grumbling and stuff, you know, and just sort of some grumping. And, you know, that, if you've ever heard one grumbling, they sound sort of like the Tasmanian devil, sort of a, you know, we heard some of that. So we knew they were there. And we knew that if, you know, if we did very much, they were going to be pissed off and be right out there on us again. But that was our opening. We jumped in that truck. And I put it in four-wheel drive because I wanted every bit of traction I could get headed back up that hill. And I put it to the floor, and I came flying up that hill so fast. When I got to the top, I was going so damn fast, I almost jumped the road that we had come in there on, you know, that we had followed. I had to slam on the brakes to keep from nosediving into the ditch on the other side of the road. And I got around the corner, and I mean, we went hauling ass out of there.
That kind of behavior is a very classic demonstration type behavior that a lot of primates do. So, very interesting.
Everyone here at Bigfoot Hotspot Radio would like to thank Audible.com. Audible.com is the internet leading provider of audiobooks with over 150,000 different titles to choose from. To download a free audiobook of your choice, go to audibletrial.com/Bigfoot Hotspot. Now, Tim, I know we're just about out of time. Scratched the surface on your stories. I wanted you to, there was an encounter that you investigated back in, I believe it was Colorado, where there was a kind of like a hunting guide that took a person out. Would you mind telling that story?
Okay. I still think this story is highly doubtful. The reason being is because I never was able to find any corroborating evidence. Now, one of my work buddies that investigated Bigfoot with me a lot when I was working out in New Mexico and other places out west, he believed it, and he died a few years ago of cancer. And he went to his grave believing that it was a 100% true story because he had a law enforcement off before he went to work for the missile command. And he had been in law enforcement for quite a number of years in Texas and Florida. And he went to his grave believing that this was a true story. Myself, I still have very, very strong doubts about it. But I'll tell you, I'll tell it to you. This other guy, that other friend of ours, he had been out there and done a TDY tour ahead of us, He said, man, y'all need to think about, since you're going to be out here this fall, you need to think about going elk hunting up Colorado. And he told us where to hunt and everything. And he told us about this guy that he knew that was a guide. And I'm going to have to say, you got to use that term very, very loosely. He's not what I, he, not, not now, now at this stage of my life, I wouldn't consider the guy a guide. I would consider him just a good old boy that knew a few good places to hunt. He wasn't much of a guy. He said, you ought to, you know, hook up with this guy. And he said, and my friend that was, family was from out there, he knew of me and my buddies, interest in Bigfoot, and that, and he had had some encounters himself in Alabama where he lived. And he said, you need to talk to this guy, this guide, when you go to meet him and ask him about what happened with him a few years ago. I said, okay. Mind you, at this time, I'm like 32 years old, and I'm 58 now, so this is quite a few years ago. We make contact with the guy. I call him up. We decide to meet. Anyway, so I drove up there one weekend, and I met him. We talked about hunting and everything and where we could go and that we were interested in doing a combination elk and mule deer hunt and yada, yada, yada. And then I said, Larry tells me that you've had a Bigfoot encounter. And he looked at me and he just clammed up. And he instantly went on, I could tell by the look in his eyes, sort of the defensive mode. And I said, you can talk to me. I said, you know, I've been investigating this thing for quite a number of years. He says, well, you know, and you know, I'll tell you some about it. And then he started telling me the story, and what it boiled down to was that supposedly he was guiding a hunter on for mule deer. From the age of the guy at that time to apparently this had taken place 3 or 4 years before. So the kid couldn't have been over 21, 22 years old at the most when this supposedly happened. He said that they had come out onto a cutover area, or an area that had been logged off and then replanted. And he said they had parked a distance away and they had walked out this logging road, and they had just sneaked out to the corner, and they were sitting there looking around with the binoculars, and they spot a mule deer, or they spot some mule deer. Start trying to maneuver a little bit to get into a little bit better position to shoot. And he said they spot some movement in the brush, in the vegetation down the hill below these mule deer. They look, and they say there's a dadgum, you know, Sasquatch there. The damn hunter instantly jacked around in the chamber and threw his rifle up like he was going to shoot. And the guide said, you know, no, 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 you know, don't shoot, don't shoot. And he said he reached up there and was going to try to knock the guy's rifle down. But before he could do it, the guy fired a shot and hit it. Up the hill in the vegetation above where the mule deer was, a bigger one popped up out of the vegetation. And he said that son of a gun let out a big scream and instantly came tearing through there, running at him. The guy's yelling at the guy, you know, run, run, run. The guy stands there and he starts trying to jack him up around him and starts shooting at the thing. Well, he short-stroked the rifle, which means that he didn't draw the bolt back far enough to eject the round that he had just fired before he started jamming the bolt forward again. And he jammed the rifle up. He short-stroked it and jammed the rifle. It was a bolt-action rifle. And the guy takes off running. As he's running, he threw his rifle. And he said that he could hear the thing coming, running, you know, charging this guy. And the guy is standing there struggling with a rifle. He said as he's running, he looks back about the time that the booger gets to the guy. He said the son of a gun ran in. He said the first thing he did, the first contact they had, he said the booger just reached out, grabbed the guy by the head and snatched his head completely off and slung it. And he said then he grabbed his arm and he said he started just pulling the guy to pieces. And the guy just never broke stride, ran to his truck, jumped in the truck and hauled ass. And he figures there's nothing he can do. You know, there's nothing he can do for the guy that's dead. Because he said, he told me he saw the booger snatch the guy's head off. And he said it wasn't that he got a hold of it and pulled and it yielded and pulled off. He said he snatched it off like it was just sitting there, like it was hardly even attached. Like, you know, as easy as you and I would pull a grape off of out of a bundle of grapes. He said he just snatched the guy's head right off and slung it, and it went flying. Anyway, he goes tearing out of there. I don't know if he went to the sheriff's department. I can't remember if he told me he called him or whatever. The sheriff and the coroner and I think a couple of deputies, he ended up taking them back up there. Supposedly, they rummaged around. They found the guy's body parts, gathered him all up, and took him out there. And he told me that he wrote it up, that they wrote it up as a bear attack. I went to the local newspaper office, and you got to remember, this was in the early 1980s, and it was before mid-1980s. This is before they had, you know, computerized archive records and stuff. So all they had was microfiche records and just big bundles of papers. And I figured that, well, it had to have been in hunting season, so it had to have been the end of September and up into October. And I figured that, you know, and it was, you know, 3 or 4 years ago. So I sat there in that newspaper office, and I went through archives, and I could not find any unusual deaths in the papers over a couple of year period there in the latter half of September or any time in October. I went down the street to the sheriff's office, and I went in there, and I asked him there was a couple of deputies sitting in there. And I asked them if they had heard any stories, if they remembered any story of a guy mule deer hunting that was killed by a bear or killed by something up there, in this particular area, you know, 3 or 4 years earlier. One of them said, no, don't remember anything like that. And the other one sort of, you know, he got a little bit of an attitude, but basically I didn't get any information out of him. And I tell my Bigfoot and buddy about me. The story and everything that because he knew that Larry had told me to ask him about it. Well, we go elk hunting with the guy, and anyway, my Bigfootin' buddy, who I'll call Carl, he decided that he was going to grill this guy. So he got the guy to tell the story to him again. And like I said, my buddy had been in law enforcement for quite a number of years before he worked for the missile command, and so he had a good nose for a BS story, and he believed it. Like I said, my buddy went to his grave believing that it was a true story. I had written it off and forgot about it. When old newspaper archives first started being available online, Bear found some articles and some accounts of a couple of different accounts of like a slave hunter hunting runaway slaves down in the Okefenokee swamp of, you know, northern Florida. And they came up on a Bigfoot. And this is back in the black powder days, you know, percussion gun days. And they started shooting at this Bigfoot, and or they called it a wild man or something like that. And it attacked them. And before they could kill it, it ran up on these three or four guys and snatched their heads off. And the manner that the Bigfoot in that story beheaded those guys, it instantly made me remember that guy's story that he had told me. That the booger in the story down in Florida had snatched those guys' heads off in exactly the same manner. Exactly. And then Bear found some other stories, where people had been killed, and that's what the booger did. When it charged in on them, the first contact with the human that they made was it just reached and just grabbed their head and just yanked it right off, snatched it right off the body. And after that, like I said, every time I found it, it made me think of that guy's story. And so I will have to say, I still think it's improbable and needs a lot more, you know, corroboration and investigation. at the time, none of that was available. You couldn't find any of that online. Oh, there was no online.
And out there in the middle of nowhere
where he lived, there was, I don't think there's any way possible that he could have come across these old newspaper accounts from down in South Georgia and North Florida. There, you know, that had been buried in archives for hundreds of years. I don't think there's any way that this guy could have come up with that.
But you know, in all my years of doing this, that's usually a ring of truth if things parallel other, you know, stories from around different locations.
It's not as low down in my probability
It's pretty hard
rating
to ignore
as,
then.
Right, exactly. But like I said, I'm not putting it forth as something that really happened at all. I'm just telling you a story that I heard that then I have come across that since then we've come across
some
corroborating accounts.
We got to have you back because I know we hardly touched any of your stories.
Yeah, absolutely.
Right.
And a lot of people have been begging us to have you on, and I'm excited to have you on. I think you did a great job. I wish that we had four.
Thank you.
Yeah, we'd love to have you back. I asked Bear if he'd come back too because I know we had to cut him short. Appreciate you coming on. We sure appreciate you sharing your stories, and we would love to have you back to share more because I know we hardly scratched the surface on it.
All righty. Well, I'll be glad to come back. And thank you guys for the opportunity.
Oh, thank you. The pleasure's ours.
Yeah, we sure appreciate it.
Mm-hmm. And we'll definitely be in touch with you.
One of these days I'm going to have to write a book and get all this stuff written down.
There you go.
Yep, absolutely.
And then we will update everyone on Sunday with our drawing contest, a few other news stories that I wanted to get to as well. So we'll do that on Sunday. Other than that, have a good night, everyone.